Good morning, everybody. Let's sing. Do you know this song? Do you know this victory? I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. All my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how we made the lame to walk again and cause the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Sing it now. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved the air I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amen. Well, we stand in that victory today, don't we?
Amen.
6 feet apart. We sing songs about healing, and then we stand 6 feet apart. We may need to do that. There's some information in your bulletin. Eddie, even though he's gone this week, likes to keep track of prayer, so it, there's a tear out in there. It has a place where you put your name, email address, and some information like that. Then it's also got a place for prayer requests, and I know that some of you may have some. We'll collect them at the end of the service today, and I'll make sure that he gets a copy of them. He's out in a beautiful area to pray, to commune with the Lord. He sent me some picture of a herd of deer yesterday and a herd of elk. Dawn is on cloud nine. Anyway, I want to thank you all for coming here, and I want to thank the people that are joining us on Facebook and YouTube as well. God bless y'all. If you have any prayer requests, you can contact us through one of those venues too. All right? Let's sing another song, all right? Our mission is to tell the world, no matter how small we feel we are, how ineffective we feel we are, our job is to tell people about Jesus. Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line. With all the punk whites, with all the never get it rights, but it turns out they're the ones you've been looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Well, Moses had stage fright, David brought a rock through a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is, everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, that's just fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, that's just fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Well, in the book of Acts, second chapter, we find a story in Scripture about a remarkable mission of a handful of people. You know, the first church started out with 12 disciples minus one, gathered in a room, afraid of what to do next or what's going to happen to them next. Within that same chapter, verse 36 of Acts 2 through 47, we're going to read together what happened. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Messiah. Peter's words pierced their hearts, and they said to him and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter replied, "Each of you must repent of your sins, turn to God, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ to show that you have received forgiveness for your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is to you and your children, and even to the Gentiles, all who have been called by the Lord our God." Then Peter continued preaching for a long time. Glyn? Amen. Then Peter continued preaching for a long time, strongly urging all of his listeners, "Save yourselves from this crooked generation." Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day about 3,000 in all. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and sharing meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all. And the apostles performed many wondrous signs and wonders. All the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved.
Amen.
We have no idea what our role is or how it will be perceived. Our role is to proclaim the message of Jesus Christ. Jesus came to save the lost. And hope is here.
Hope is here. Shout the news to everyone. It's a new day, peace has come. Jesus saves. Mercy triumphs at the cross. Love has come to rescue us. Jesus saves. Hope is here. What a joyful noise we'll make as we join with heaven's song to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. And at last, every debt has been repaid. Broken hearts can be remade. Jesus saves. Sing above the storms of life. Sing it through the darkest night. Jesus saves. Free at last. What a joyful noise we'll make as we join with heaven's song to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Sing it out to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. You save, you heal, restore, reveal your Father's heart to us. You rose to raise us from the grave. your spirit lives in us. Sing it out to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Sing it out to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Sing it out to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves.
Amen. And the scripture read today came from a preacher who looked out to a small group. He said, you must repent. Turn from your sins and follow Jesus. And they did.
Your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I see your praise will ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, and rid of all her shame, and known by her true name. And it's why I sing, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, you will be praised. You will be praised. Angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. And it's why I sing, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Oh,
Isn't it wonderful in a relationship that is so serious when turbulence threatens it to come out of the turbulence and rejoin the blessing of unity? Our Father loves us. He loves us where we are, in that while we were yet sinners, part of the deal was He loved us so much that He sent Jesus, even back then, for us now. Let's live for Him. Father God, thank You for Your message that has cascaded down through the ages to Your people who were at best fickle, coming close to You at one time, falling away, coming back through centuries and centuries. The Israelites demonstrated sometimes what our lives today are like. Father, help us to take this moment of the week to refocus, Lord, where we failed You, where we've tried to turn gray areas into areas that are okay. I pray that Your conviction would be upon us, because the world is looking to us. And even though we see ourselves as a nobody, You see us as Your child. Father, I pray that You would help us as we hear the message today to identify in ourselves what the Holy Spirit is trying to get across to us. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We are blessed today to have Glyn Murphy to come back and lead us in the Word of God. Glyn, would you come and share with us this morning?
Thank You, Lord, that we are in Your hands. You are our protection. You are our defense. You are our hope. You are our strength. You are our healing. Lord, You are our life. And we just want to tell You how much we love You and praise You and thank You today. And ask You to speak to our hearts today about Your will and Your purpose. in this time. We pray this in the powerful and wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, this is a strange time. It's a strange time. There have been 39,959,000, and at the count at the time they listed this, 651 cases of coronavirus in our little ball we call Earth. And 1,114,000 deaths. Now, that's a lot. In the U.S., we've had over 8 million cases and 219,000 deaths. Now, we've all kind of learned a lot about coronavirus lately. We wash our hands and we stay away from each other and all that. But the truth is, there are a lot of people in our world, their only defense is absolute terror and fear. But see, we know something different, don't we? We know something about the Creator of this world. And if we are His children living in this world, then life is not about breathing and heart beating and eating and surviving. You know that life is just temporary. And there's something much bigger and much more important than this thing we call life. So what is it that makes life life for believers? Is it staying afloat? Making it till tomorrow? Just existing? Well, no, none of us would say that, I don't think. Although the world seems to think it's that way. Just got to hang on, make it through today. This is the thing that makes life, life for a believer in Christ is this one thing, purpose. You're not here by accident. You're not here just to use up space, breathe air. God put you here. He created you and made you just the way you are, with all the talents and abilities and personality and makeup that you are. He made you just like that for a specific purpose. And life's not about how long I can keep this body going. Life is about fulfilling that purpose. Now that's different, isn't it? You see, God made you just the way you are to fulfill a purpose God designed for you. And if you want life to be fulfilled for you, you fulfill that purpose. If you fulfill that purpose, you have meaning in life. Ripe young age of 70 years old. When I was my senior year in high school, I was a healthy, skinny kid, and I started having some health problems. And by the time I graduated, I was skinnier still. And I went in the hospital, in and out for a long time. Got down to 114 pounds. Got down to one point that my legs were just so skinny. My knees were balls like you see starving people, and that's the way I looked. Never thought I'd make it to 30. But God had a purpose. And God called me to preach in the midst of all that bad stuff. And I thought, well, Lord, you know, you may need some advice on this. You probably got this one wrong. But God had a purpose and a plan. And all of a sudden, because it was no longer about being healthy and strong and normal. It was about a purpose. And the truth is, every believer in Christ has a purpose to glorify God in your world in His way. And He has formed you and made you and designed you just the way you are for that purpose. And in your daily life, honoring God, loving Him, and finding opportunities to serve Him fulfills a purpose that is not just temporal, but it's eternal. Now, God has sent a pandemic, allowed a pandemic to come into our world. And in that, He has never changed the concept of your purpose to glorify God in the midst of where you are. And life is really, it's not about how long you live, how well you get living, how successful you are in business or in relationships or whatever else it is out there. Life is about fulfilling that purpose in your life. And you see, through the ages, Christians have been called to honor God and serve Him, and sometimes to die serving Him. I want you to know about God. God knows all about you. He knows all about your past. And gratefully, He's forgiving. He knows all about your present. He knows what's going on around you that you don't even know about. He knows about your future. He has a purpose and plan in your life for every day that you live. He is the giver of life. And He has called us to honor Him and serve Him, glorify Him in our lives. Believers through the ages have suffered and died for the cause of Christ, gave their lives to honor Christ. Well, let me tell you something. Those people didn't die 1 minute too soon or 1 minute too late. Your days are numbered by God. And let me tell you what, the one thing that's far worse than dying when you're going to supposed to die is living past when you're supposed to die. You know why? Because if you don't have a purpose, you don't have a life. And the worst thing in all the world for me would be to live 1 minute past God's purpose for me. And it's for you too. God has a wonderful plan for your life, and He will use you, whatever circumstances we're in, He will use you in that, and He is your rock, He is your defense, He is your healing, He is your strength, He is life. This pandemic came and rocked our world, all around the world. Oh, what a terrible thing it's been. Horrible. People just all over the world. People have died. It's terrible. But God knew all about it. He still had a purpose and plan. And in the midst of it, He has done some amazing things. And this pandemic hit, and you know, I'm a preacher, so it's like a car guy. If he likes cars, he wants to see cars and likes to watch cars and talk about cars. And so I like preaching. I like preaching, and I like listening to preachers. So this pandemic hit, and you know, they were talking about not having church and stuff. You know, oh no. So man, I get on the internet, you know, and I watch different churches, you know, before I go to church. And some of them have early services. You can watch early service, and then you can go to church and have service there, come home and watch another service when you get home. You know, it's great. Well, anybody ever heard of First Baptist Dallas? Yeah. Well, I went to Crystal College, you know, in the midst of First Baptist stuff a lot there. So I click it on and watch. In the beginning of the pandemic, when all this thing struck and everything was going crazy, First Baptist Dallas had a big service and on internet and on TV. And they had invitation time. And people could call in or click in to commit their life to Christ. And people there. 3,000 people got saved in one service. You know, that sounds familiar, doesn't it? 3,000? The day of Pentecost? And thousands more since then. In that church and other churches. God has done amazing things through this pandemic. The world is shaken. The world is afraid. But you know what disturbed me through all of this? Is that when our society was shutting down and everybody was afraid and all these things were closing down, churches were closing down, and man, it's like everybody's scared to death. And the world's ears were open. And mostly, not everyone, but mostly, our churches were silent. Too often, as scared as the lost people were. Let me tell you, in the midst of a crisis, God is always working. Let me tell you one little thing that happened during the pandemic. They made these rules. Try to you know, curb this thing. One of them says, we're not going to allow any elective surgeries. Isn't that wonderful? No elective surgeries. People need all these surgeries, can't get it. Everybody's, oh, that's awful, that's awful. Well, let me tell you a little sad thing about that. A little surgical procedure was also canceled because it was considered elective. It's called abortions. Did you know that in one of the worst periods of deaths, coronavirus, in that same period of time, twice as many babies were allowed to live that would have been aborted as the number of people who died in the pandemic? God's in charge. He is good. But the thing I've been disappointed in is mostly our churches have been silent to the world about this. And many churches just shut down and don't meet and don't do anything. I'm grateful for you guys. Man, God's still on his throne, isn't he? He's still in charge. Let me tell you something else about this. And I'm sure you probably already know this, but sometimes we need to be reminded of it. Before Glyn Murphy was ever born, before anybody ever knew he was going to be around, God knew. And God had a plan for my life. He had a plan and a purpose for it. And this pandemic didn't thwart that plan. I was born before I ever knew God. I knew anything. God had a plan and purpose laid out for my life. He was working that plan. And he gave me the right parents and sent me to the right church and had to bump me back a few times to get me straightened out, you know? That's why I got all these knots up here. It took us several, you know? But he had a calling in my life, had a purpose for my life. And my life is only worth living because I have a purpose. When my purpose is done, I don't want to be here 1 second longer than God's purpose. Because I know, and my wife could attest to it, if I don't have a purpose, I'll mess it up really bad. Right? Man, when God's time is ready, I'm ready. Today, tomorrow, 100 years from now. I don't want to be here without God's purpose. And let me tell you, you, as a believer in Christ, have a message for the world out there that doesn't understand any of this. It makes they are terrified. The world is confused and terrified at this unsettling. We could die. People are scared to death. And we have a message of life and hope. And whether my life is, you know, if I conk out before I get out the door, you know, if that's time, I'm happy with that. If he was to keep me around a lot longer, I might need to help my wife out a little bit, but that's okay too. As long as I have a purpose, I have a reason to be alive. And if I don't have a purpose, then take me home. It's going to be so much better. Don't be afraid. As a Christian, don't be afraid. Be courageous. Bold. Be vocal. This is the greatest opportunity I believe the church has had in 100 years to speak to a lost world about the power and wonder and grace and mercy and healing power of Almighty God, that He's at work and people are afraid and they are confused, and God is the answer. He set us here for a reason. And that purpose is to proclaim the name of Jesus to a lost and dying world. Entrusted to you. Am I cutting on and off? Sound like it to me. Okay, well, over here, is that better? Seem like I move right over here. I don't know. Well, I want you to know this, that God has a wonderful plan for you. He loves you. He has put you in a particular set of circumstances with the people that are in your life that are watching and listening and need your witness, your confidence, your trust in God, your faith, and the message of life in Christ. He has a purpose for you. And there's nothing more important than fulfilling that purpose. God is doing some amazing things in the midst of this. We don't hear about it in the press. We don't hear about it. We don't hear about most of the things that God is doing. It just doesn't get broadcast. It's not big news. But let me tell you, God's at work. And He has called us to honor Him and serve Him and be a witness and a testimony in the midst of all of this. And we have a purpose. Do you know what your purpose is? Do you know anyone that's really struggling right now in their life? A comfort to them. Talk to them. Share with them. Share with them the peace that you Christ. People need to hear. They're desperate to hear. And I ask you to join me in prayer for our churches to speak up in this time. To speak to the world the message of life and hope and trust and comfort and healing that God has for us. America needs revival. And never has there been a time of crisis in the world that God hasn't worked in amazing ways when God's people speak up. You have a voice. This church is a powerful witness in this community. And people are just downright scared to death. Running around with our little masks on and hiding away from seeing anybody. Did you know that in the midst of this pandemic, there's another tragedy going on? There's a tragedy called suicide. People are lonely, isolated, afraid, and have lost hope. And there's so many people committing suicide. It's sad. And we have the answer. And we have the answer. I'm grateful for this church and the ministry it has in this community. I'm grateful for the heart that you have for the things of God. I'm thankful for the attitude you have of praise and worship before God. And people need that so desperately. And we cannot, we must not keep it to ourselves. Find someone, call someone, check on people. It's amazing. It's amazing what just call up to them, hey, how you doing? Just wanted to check on, see how you doing. Just praying for you today. You doing okay? I started not pastoring now, so you know, but I have a heart for pastors. And so I started just praying for pastors. And it's amazing how God works when we just pray. Man, you can get a little closet and pray and reach the world. Do you know that? Praying for people. I pray for your pastor every week. He's a brother in Christ and a great guy. But I pray for him. God will use him and bless this church. God hears and answers prayer. We need to pray. We need to step outside our normal circles and share and love. A person of courage, faith, and optimism because you belong to his work and he will work through you and in you. And I pray that God will bless this church and the ministries of this church and bless this community through this church. Because there are a lot of lonely, confused, hurting people in the midst of this difficult time that need to hear. Maybe you're here today. Your life hasn't been what it ought to be. Maybe you're here today, you've never put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. I hope each and every one of you have, but if you haven't, you can. You can simply agree with God that you're a sinner. The Bible says all have sinned, come short of the glory of God. There's not a single one of us that don't need to be saved. Today, if you've never put your trust and faith in Him, I urge you, with all that I am, to make the most important decision that you'll ever make, to commit your life to Christ, to invite Him to come into your life, to forgive you of your sins, and be your Lord. And He will. Maybe you're here as a believer today. Today you struggle with purpose and ministry. Man, find your ministry. Find somebody that's hurting and care for them. Share with people. Somebody that's lonely. Pray for one another. Listen, the power of prayer is just amazing. It's supernatural. Just start praying for somebody. Start praying for the church, for your pastor, for your neighbor. God hears prayer. And He answers prayer. And you know what? When you pray and God answers prayer, woo! There's nothing like it. Man, it's exciting to see God work and to hear your prayers. We can change the world through prayer and ministry and service. And right now, it's a rare, rare opportunity. Doesn't come along very often in the history of the world to be a witness and testimony and minister in the midst of a pandemic like this. All the confusion, all the worry, all the wonder, all the fear and confusion makes hearts open wide to truth. And you have the truth. love somebody, pray for somebody, comfort somebody this week. And you know what? I promise you, as much blessing as you give to someone else, you'll receive even more. That's the way God works. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and your mercy and your grace. Thank you, Lord, that you are sufficient in every circumstance. Nothing is too great for you. Lord, thank you that you are God of healing and mercy and power and love. And Lord, I pray that you just use each of us as ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Lord, our days are numbered. Life is short. But Lord, each day with purpose in Christ is rich and wonderful, and help us to fulfill that purpose. Lord, when our time is done, Lord, we are ready. We are ready to come and be with you. But until then, Lord, help us to be faithful, to be effective, and to be servants of Christ in this world. Lord, we love you, we honor you, and praise you. In this we pray, in the powerful and wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. We ask you. Thank you so much. It's such a privilege to be here and to worship with you and be a part of this fellowship. I pray God will bless you and use you this week for His glory and for His purpose. God bless you. Thank you, brother.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, I anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, then I'm him, on him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
God bless all of you, those of you that are here and those of you that have joined us on Facebook and YouTube. I want to encourage you this week, go have a victory for Jesus, all right? God bless you. You're dismissed.